It's a great pleasure to welcome you to this, one of our inaugural lectures. We, like many universities, expect our new professors to be able to make such an inaugural, but we do it in our own particular way, in our own particular style. And it's a great privilege for me to hear some of my colleagues. One week it may be, or one month it may be about Shakespeare. Another it may be about some very exotic physiology of plants or whatever. But I have to say, this title of Bits, Bytes and Blood is one of the most exciting that I've had in the last few years. But as I say, the University of Chester has been around quite a long time. We were formed in 1839 by the Church of England as the very first teacher training college in the country, and we are still here on our site, and education is still a very important component of what we do. But all around education, there have been new disciplines, new activities growing, and the most recent have been those in engineering and developments in computing and mathematics. And it's in that context that we have this particular lecture. I hope you will enjoy it thoroughly. I'm sure you will. And it gives me very great pleasure to welcome the Dean of the Faculty of Science and Engineering, and Provost and Pro Vice Chancellor with responsibility for our Thornton campus, Professor Nick Avis, to introduce our speaker this evening. Nick.
Thank you very much, Vice Chancellor. So it's my delight to introduce Professor Nigel John. I've known Nigel for over 20 years. In fact, I think we met in the offices of Silicon Graphics in Manchester when I was just about to purchase a horrendously expensive Silicon Graphics machine. I think that blew the whole of the budget from the University of Hull's Department of Computer Science in one go. But anyway, it was a really interesting introduction. Nigel was born in Swansea. He went off and studied mathematics at the University of Bath and then carried on to do his PhD there. And then went into industry for a while with Zeneca Pharmaceuticals. And then later he joined Silicon Graphics, where, as I said, I met Nigel for the first time. And then he ventured into academia, had a very successful stint at the University of Manchester, where he headed up the Visualization Center. That was actually a support service for academic excellence. And then from there, Nigel went off to Bangor, where he remained for some period of time. He headed up the computer graphics unit there, and he did many exciting and interesting projects, mostly related into the medical domain, but venturing into other areas like, I think it's rugby union, isn't it, that you're interested in. So Nigel's done a lot of interesting projects in the medical field. He's been awarded prizes as well for his work. So Nigel is actually the only UK recipient of the Satava Award. That's associated with a long-running activities in the States, the Medicine Meets Virtual Reality conference series. And he's also a member of the Learned Society of Wales, fellow of the Learned Society of Wales. Nigel, as I say, joined the University of Chester just over a year ago, and came here to help us establish the research credentials of the Department of Computer Science, and I'm delighted that he did so. He's always been a great pleasure to work with, and I'd like to invite Professor Nigel John to come and give his inaugural speech.
Well, thank you very much, Vice-Chancellor, and thank you, Nick, for that introduction. And thank you all for coming. It's really great to see so many friends in the audience, and I'm delighted to have the opportunity to talk to you, not for too long, I promise, but to give you a little bit of an overview of what I've been doing throughout my academic career mainly, and also a glimpse of what I hope to do in the next few years as well, before I can finally get around to retiring. So we're here at the University of Chester's Parkgate Road campus, which is the traditional site of the university, but the university is expanding, and as the Vice-Chancellor said, one of the new parts of the university is at the Thornton Science Park, which is in the northeast of Chester. So I thought I'd better give you a glimpse of where that is. And there's a little fly-in, courtesy of Google Earth, just to show you exactly where the Thornton Science Park is. And in fact, I've shown you this particular video clip for another reason as well. As Nick said, we first met when I worked for Silicon Graphics. And Silicon Graphics was a company that specialized in quite expensive computer graphics hardware. And they, in the late 1990s, they had a very famous demonstration called From Space to a New Face. And it was exactly this. You started with the Earth, and you zoomed in closer and closer to a different country. They actually used Switzerland and the Swiss Alps. And to actually get that to run in real time, you had to buy some hardware off them for tens of thousands of pounds. That Google Earth app, which I recorded straight off my smartphone a couple of days ago, is a great demonstration of how the hardware and the capability has changed in a relatively short period. And I would have had to have paid, you know, £50,000 plus to do that in real time 20 years ago. Today I could do it on my smartphone. So that has had a great impact on what I'm going to talk about today as well, the power of the computer graphics hardware. And I can take advantage of that. And I think that continues to happen as well. Things are getting faster and cheaper all the time. On the right-hand side as well, because Thornton Science Park is where all my equipment is, and a lot of the projects I'll mention today are reliant on specialized virtual reality, if you like, equipment, I'm going to have to invite you all to come to the Thornton site in order to have demonstrations in my lab. But I did bring one thing with me, and I've got it in here. One of my most expensive bits of kit from the lab is my Google Cardboard. And the two clips you see on the right-hand side, if you want a real-time demonstration later on, you can have a virtual tour, 3D tour of the site and my office as well. So I do have one bit of equipment for you to try out a little bit later. So the talk. Thought I'd start with a little bit of motivation about what this talk is going to be about. And as was said earlier, I started my interest probably when I was doing my degree at the University of Bath, my interest in computer graphics. I always liked mathematics, and when I went to university, I found I was quite good at doing this computing as well. And I really enjoyed my mathematics degree. It was mathematics with computing, actually, and so it's a bit of a mixture. And apart from abstract algebra, which I could never get the hang of, I really enjoyed the undergraduate degree, and in particular, the computer graphics modules, which Phil Willis, who's here today, was my first lecturer in computer graphics and went on to become my PhD supervisor. And computer graphics is great because you need to be a mathematician to really use computer graphics, and you need to be able to do computing and programming. And those were my two labs, my academic labs, and computer graphics brought them together. So the bits and bytes part of the talk is to do that, using this technology, computer graphics, and related technologies. And that's what I love to do. But as my career progressed, and my PhD was actually more to do with computer animation, 3D animation, but as I went into industry and I started working for the likes of Zeneca, I got introduced to medical applications. And I saw that this technology could add value to medical applications, such as training, or maybe to aid in the operating theatre itself. So that's where the blood comes in. There will be a little bit of blood later on in the talk, but only a little bit. And it's virtual blood as well. So if you're squeamish, it shouldn't be too much of a problem for you. So that's the motivation of the talk. And it's also an excuse for me to revisit some of the projects I've done in the past and also give you a little glimpse of what I'm doing now and into the future. And I want to start off by talking a little bit about ultrasound. This might be an odd thing to start with, but ultrasound has turned up in various different capacities in different projects over the last 10 to 20 years that I've been involved with. And, of course, I'm sure everybody in the audience is familiar with ultrasound. I've got a classic image of an ultrasound image on the slide, which every lady who's pregnant will have an ultrasound to monitor the status of the unborn child. And the way these images are demonstrated is using ultrasound, which is just high-frequency sound waves, and you use a probe to inject, if you like, the sound waves into tissue, and the sound will be echoed back. And different tissues echo it back at different rates, and that time it takes for the sound to come back can be interpreted in an image format, and you get images like this. And this is a 2D ultrasound scanner, and that is still the most common type of ultrasound scanner. But there was a particular project that I worked on while I was at Zeneca Pharmaceuticals, and they had an ultrasound scanner, 2D ultrasound scanner. And one of the projects that they were running at the time, they had a new drug which was meant to help the plaque buildup in an artery. It was meant to start to dissolve some of the plaque buildup. And they wanted to monitor the effectiveness of this new drug that they had in trial. And they wanted a way of measuring plaque in the arteries. And they were using ultrasound, 2D ultrasound images to scan. They were actually rabbits that they were experimenting on, and they used ultrasound to get the data. But with a team of people, we had this idea, how can we convert these 2D ultrasound images into 3D data? So we could start to maybe measure the volume of the plaque buildup on the artery walls. And this is still one of the projects I remember greatly. It was my first experience of being part of a multidisciplinary team and putting together a really novel and unique system. And although today there are 3D ultrasound scans more readily available, in the late 1990s, nobody really heard of 3D ultrasound. Ultrasound is just 2D. And what we did, a simple idea, we've got our ultrasound probe, the ultrasound transducer, which is acquiring the images for us. Why don't we put onto that some sort of tracking device so that as an image is being captured, we know exactly where that image is in 3D space, its position and orientation. And if we have enough of these 2D images, we can actually populate a whole volume with the ultrasound data and create a 3D volume from the 2D images. And the reason that there's some videotapes, if those of you who remember VHS videotapes, we actually use videotapes to store the data. The images went onto the video frames, and the audio track of the videotape we use to store the information from the tracking device, and we also recorded ECG data, so we know the heartbeat as well. And the image you see on the right is a snapshot of some software that I wrote, which was to interpret that data from the videotapes and to extract the video frames at known locations in 3D space and build up a 3D volume from that data. And this is an example of what we were able to achieve. This is a reconstruction of one of the arteries that was ultrasound scanned, and the red and yellow colors you see there represents the plaque on the artery wall. And we were able to actually measure the volume of that data. And that was the first time that we could get 3D information, if you like, from these 2D ultrasound images. So that was a project I remember fondly, and that paper is still cited. It's up to 200 citations now, and it's still every month somebody else has cited that paper. So it's one of the projects that's really made a mark. And it was an inspiration for me as well. So that showed me that you can go from 2D medical data and create 3D models out of that. And that's something I've continued to exploit. Other common image modalities in the hospital, some of you may have had a CAT scan or an MRI scan. This is actually an MRI scan, and it's actually me. So this was done at the Royal Liverpool Hospital. And on the right, you can see a 3D reconstruction of that data. That is what I would look like if I had all my hair shaved off. And this is what I would look like if you put a clipping plane through my head and wanted to examine my brain and other internal anatomy. So representing what's traditionally been a 2D image format in 3D opens up some new possibilities to the end user, not the surgeon or other clinicians. Maybe for diagnosis, or maybe to help plan a procedure. And when I went to the Manchester Visualization Centre, one of the projects that we did was to help the surgeon do just that. This was in the early 2000s. It was still at a time when the computer power that you needed was the big Silicon Graphics expensive computer. And in the Manchester Visualization Centre, we were lucky enough to get a big grant. I think it was over £500,000 to have an infinite reality Silicon Graphics supercomputer in the Manchester Visualization Centre. But the surgeon you see here, Rory McCloy, he was a liver surgeon at the Manchester Royal Infirmary. And he wanted something better than just having the 2D images of the CAT scan to look at in the operating theatre. He wanted that 3D data. And what we were able to do at the time was to render the data on our Silicon Graphics supercomputer, then transmit the volume rendered version of that data over the network into the operating theatre. And you see on the right there the sort of quality of the 3D images that we could create. And in this particular patient, there's a big tumour in there quite close to the liver. So while Rory was doing the operation, to be able to see in 3D what was beneath the surface of the patient he was about to cut into was a great help to him. And he used this system that we set up in the early 2000s, and we even had the BBC Tomorrow's World programme come up and film this as well. Of course, things get quickly out of date, and he could actually do that on his laptop now. He doesn't need a big supercomputer to generate the graphics. That could be done on a laptop today. But in its time, that filled a niche, and it was quite novel and added value to a procedure in the operating theatre. So I've come to the point in my career where I can see how we can create 3D models from medical data that would commonly be acquired in a hospital. So here's another example where ultrasound comes back in. And in fact, this was partly due to my first meeting with Derek Gould, who will be speaking a little bit later. And Derek is an interventional radiologist, and he was at the Royal Liverpool Hospital at the time. And he came to visit me and see some of the equipment I was working on. This was at the time when I was at Manchester and about to leave to go to Bangor. And he wanted to develop tools to help train his fellow radiologists. And one of the procedures that they do uses ultrasound. And if they're doing a biopsy, where they want to take a sample of some tissue, they would use an ultrasound image to identify the anatomy, the target, if you like. And you can actually follow a needle on an ultrasound image as well. You see that white arrow is pointing to a white blob. That is actually the needle in the blood vessel. So you use ultrasound to guide a needle to the target. It's good for the patient because that probably means that you'll get the needle to the right place the first time you try. And you don't have to keep jabbing it in until you get it right. So it is good news for the patient. So this needs a bit more than what I'd done previously. Previously, I'd been taking the medical data and rendering it in a way that could help the surgeon to understand the anatomy of that patient. Now I want to start building a system to enable me to interact with that data and maybe introduce some other technology as well. So I want to feel the force of a needle, my virtual needle, going into my virtual patient. So I need some sort of force feedback to enable me to do that. And there are joysticks, force feedback joysticks, which will enable me to do that. I also want to be able to see my virtual patient perhaps in 3D using stereoscopy displays. The sort of technology that if you go to see a 3D movie at Cheshire Oaks, for example, that technology is quite common today, but 10 years ago, it wasn't so common. So we started to use this 3D technology, use force feedback or haptic devices, and have the computer and the virtual patient model reacting as naturally as possible. So tissue would deform, and the patient needed to be alive, so needed to be breathing, not just a virtual cadaver. So all these things had to be started to be integrated. Again, this is another example where I couldn't achieve that alone and needed to work with other experts. And one set of experts that were great guys to work with were the clinical engineers at the Royal Liverpool Hospital and Derek Gould as well. And they gave us an important part of the equation. It was, how much force do you actually need to stick a needle into somebody? I had no idea how much force I needed. So what they did is put sensors on real needles so that when they were doing procedures on their patients, they could record data, like is what is summarized in the graph there, which shows a force profile over time as a needle has been inserted into different tissue types. They could give us that data, which was really, really useful. And one of the projects, this was the project that Frank Vidal worked on for his PhD, and eventually became part of a bigger project as well, which we became part of a bigger consortium called CRAVE, Collaborators in Radiological Interventions. And that involved other universities like Imperial, and Fernando's here from Imperial, and Leeds, and Hull, and Liverpool, and Bangor, and Manchester. And we created some really interesting simulators. And this was the start of it. So we took that data from those force feedback adapted needles and put it into our virtual model so that we would work out in our virtual model where the tip of the needle would be. We would cross-reference that with the CT scan of the patient, so the tip of the needle would be in a particular part of the CT scan, and we could look up the value of the what's called the Hounsfield unit, the value of the CT data, and use that to have a lookup table which mapped those values to the appropriate force that we needed. So as you put the needle in, the force would change according to what tissue it was going through. And this turned out to be really good fidelity. It really felt like a real needle going into tissue. And you can see a couple of movies here from the simulator. And we have two force feedback joysticks. One is your ultrasound scanner. And you see some ultrasound-like data being generated. And the other force feedback joystick is on a needle, which we push into the patient. And I'll just quickly show you that simulator in action as well. I'm going to go to my colleagues over at the BBC Wales news desk who are going to tell you a little bit about this.
3D virtual patients could be used to train staff in carrying out pinhole surgery thanks to a new simulator developed by a team at Bangor University. It uses the same technology found in high-tech computer games to recreate the feeling of feeding a needle through the body. Our health correspondent, Hal Griffith, went to see how it works.
It may not look much like surgery, but with his 3D specs on, Professor Nigel John is able to see and feel what it's like to work with a real patient. This simulator uses two high-tech joysticks to recreate the sensation of an ultrasound probe and a needle actually touching the body. He's part of a team that's been developing the technology for use in the health service.
Lots of procedures which stop off with a needle going into us. And so it's meant to be able to train scanning the patient with an ultrasound image to look for the target, the kidney or the liver or an artery that you want to punch with a needle, and then to actually have the sensation of a needle going into the patient.
Some of the technology being used here will be very familiar to fans of the latest in computer games, although of course the whole point of this one is to save a person's life. As I move the needle around, I can feel the sensation of hitting skin, but there's a warning. I've just stuck the needle into the colon.
I'll stop it there, even though we were about to get on to a little clip of Derek telling about some of the clinical benefits, but in the interest of time, I'll move on. And here's another example of ultrasound coming up where I least expected it as well. So in that previous project, it was a good example of where I wanted to start to use the sense of touch and haptic devices with the 3D rendering. And that works really well if you want to model a tool that you hold in your hands. So a needle was ideal, and the stylus of the joystick was quite similar to holding a needle. And you're getting the force feedback through the stylus, same as you would get it through the needle. But there are lots of other procedures where you want the force feedback to be directly on your fingertips. So you press, if I press on this table, and I get the force directly on my fingertips. I'm not holding a stylus to do that. So how can we get tactile responses directly to our fingers? This is one of the big research challenges that still hasn't been solved, but starting to be solved. And one way it can be done, and this is one way I've been experimenting with, is using ultrasound. But in this case, we're not going to use ultrasound to generate images. We're going to use ultrasound to
generate a force field, if you like. So ultrasound is just a sound wave. So in this simplified diagram here, representing the sound wave as a sort of sine wave. And the source of the ultrasound is a transducer. If you can focus the output from two transducers on the same point in space, then the sound waves amplify each other. And if you start to extrapolate that, you could build something like this. So this is a device that one of my PhD students, Gary Young, developed. And here we've got an array of ultrasound transducers. There's, I think it's 276 of them altogether in this hexagon-shaped bowl, 271. So each of these is emitting an ultrasound sound wave. And the hexagon is bowl-shaped so that they naturally focus on a point which is about 15 centimeters above the bowl. So what happens when we turn it on? We'll see shortly. So Gary is dropping these polystyrene chips at that focal point about 15 centimeters above the array. And there's obviously a force there because the polystyrene chip is being blown away. So all those sound waves focused on a single point produce a force field. You drop the chip outside the focal point and there was nothing there. It just dropped to the surface. So we're starting to get something in space. You can't see anything, but you can feel something. You can feel a tactile response. And we wanted to use this to mimic the sensation of feeling for a pulse, feeling for an artery on your arm. And so you can see here that we can modulate the signal to on and off, so you get a pulse-like effect. And you see that coma paper is being deformed and not deformed in a sort of pulse-like fashion. So this was really interesting. I must admit, we weren't the originators of this idea. It was the University of Tokyo published a paper on doing this, but we were the first people to explore this in the context of a medical application, like feeling for a pulse. So the electronics are now being put inside a cardboard box, no expense spared, and that bit of polystyrene there is meant to represent a patch of skin. And with the polystyrene chip on there, you can see it's bobbing up and down. But if you put your fingers there, you actually feel a sensation, which feels a lot like a pulse. One of the possible advantages of doing this with these ultrasound transducers is that we can direct where that focal point is, so we can start to have a virtual environment where we can decide where we want a particular force to appear. And I think that's one of the key elements of maybe building the Star Trek holodeck, and where you have holograms which you can actually feel as well as see, but those holograms are moving around, so you need the force field to move around with them. So maybe that's the very beginnings of that sort of technology. And that leads me into virtual reality, which has been a big passion of mine. Virtual reality is in a phase where it's getting popular again, but it's been around really since the 1980s or earlier. The first ever head-mounted display was actually built in the 1960s. But we're getting to a point where the technology is getting to be cheap enough and realistic enough to have some interesting potential in terms of real-life applications. So what I mean by virtual reality is to be able to use a collection of technologies, so sight, touch, and maybe other senses, to interact with my 3D generated objects using my natural senses and skills. And the ultrasound-guided biopsy simulator was one example of that. But you don't necessarily need expensive hardware. And one of the first VR projects that I was involved with, and then this is back in my Manchester days, was just a web-based system. And we developed some training tools to enable medical students to learn how to do procedures by interacting with a 3D patient. And what you see in these snapshots are completely run within a web browser. So we were using the virtual reality modeling language to create the 3D elements. And this project evolved into a successful European-funded project. And Fernando from Imperial was one of the partners in this project as well. So I started off quite low-tech, web-based VR. And we revisited this idea as well. A few years later, when tablets became very popular, we went back to some of those examples. This is a neurosurgical example. And what you're seeing now is a live video snapshot from my iPad, which I did a couple of days ago. And this is for a neurosurgery procedure. You have to puncture the ventricles in the center of the brain with a needle to drain off some fluid. And actually, I'm going to fail to do it here because I can't actually see where the brain and the ventricles are. And my first attempt at doing it was unsuccessful. But luckily, it's a virtual patient, so I can try again. And this time, I might be a bit more successful. And if I do puncture the ventricles, some fluid will come out, and some fluid comes out at the end. And then I can visually see how well I did, where the needle is. The red organ you see there is the ventricles. And I can look at my results, and oh dear, I didn't do particularly well there. But luckily, I'm not going to be doing any neurosurgery on any of you. So, but this tool, designed for use on an iPad, actually is effective. And we took the iPads to a neurosurgery boot camp, which is an annual event that all the medical students who want to specialize in neurosurgery go to, and it's actually held in Manchester. And we did a validation study there where we had some of the students using the iPad tool, others didn't, and we compared their performance on a mannequin in doing this procedure. And we were able to statistically prove that the guys who used our iPad application did the task better. More recently, we've created yet another version of this neurosurgery procedure. And another bit of kit I've got in my lab is a stereoscopic display. It's called the Z-space display. I really like this display. It produces fantastic 3D images, and you really need to come and have a go at it to understand how good it is. But the best I could do for now is play you a little bit of the Z-space corporate video, which shows you their display in action. So you have this display, and it's sort of, at the moment, it's at a 45-degree angle in front of you. And the user, with a stylus, it looks as if he's picking up real physical objects and holding them in front of him. But these are all computer-generated objects. But when you use this, and you have to wear polarized glasses to see the stereo, it really does seem like you've got real objects floating in front of the screen. It is a fantastic display, and I really, really like using it. So we had the idea of taking our tablet-based application and porting it to this display, which we did. So the image you see on the right is a Photoshop mock-up, but that is really what it is like. You have a life-size human head coming out of the screen at you. And with the stylus, you do that same procedure of inserting the needle through the brain to puncture the ventricles. We thought this was a great step forward, and we went back to the same neurosurgery boot camp a year later to test this out. And we got some of our psychology experts to come with us. Simon is in the audience, is one of them. And our hypothesis was that this was going to be better. You know, compared with the iPad, using this 3D display, they were going to do better at this procedure. Turned out they didn't. And the iPad was better than this Z-space screen with a 3D stereoscopy. So that was an interesting lesson. We just had this paper published. It was accepted finally last month. And it's going to come out in presence soon. And it was not what we expected. So research doesn't always do what you expect. It throws up surprises. And it was a surprise that this high-fidelity stereoscopic display wasn't as good as an iPad version of the same application. Why that is, you can read the paper. We've got some ideas about why that may be. There's other examples as well. I won't dwell on this slide. This is another interventional radiology procedure. It simulates training for something called the Seldener technique, where you have to insert a guide wire and catheter into a blood vessel. I put this in because Chris Hughes was supposed to be here in the audience. I can't see. Oh, he is there. So I put this in so I didn't upset Chris, because Chris worked on this project while he was at Bangor. And again, this was in collaboration with Derek and the CRAVE Consortium. And another example of using haptics with stereo. I need to move on, and so I want to talk a little bit more about some more recent projects and some of the things I've been doing at Chester. And 2016 has been an interesting year for virtual reality, and that's largely due to the availability of these devices. These are head-mounted displays, like goggles that you wear, and they completely immerse you in a virtual environment. And what's been interesting about this year is that these devices are coming available aimed at the consumer market. So they're relatively cheap. Now, £500 and perhaps a little bit more, but still very affordable. The first two on that list I've already got in my lab. The third one will be coming to my lab as soon as it's finally fabricated. It's a Kickstarter project. The fourth one I do have, I bought that myself for home use. But what can we do with these devices? Well, my father had to use a motorized wheelchair in the latter years of his life. And I can remember going to his house and being a bit shocked by the state of the furniture and the doors. Because when you drive these wheelchairs around, it's so easy to crash into furniture and on objects, maybe even people. And one of our ideas to use a head-mounted display and a virtual reality environment was to build a driving simulator, but not a driving cars, but driving powered wheelchairs like this. And so this is a project that's still ongoing, and Tom Day, my PhD student, who's here he is on screen, has built this first prototype in virtual reality. You can see him wearing the head-mounted display there. And on the lower part of the screen, you can see what he's seeing. He's seeing it in 3D, though. We can only see it in 2D on the movie. But for him, it does feel like he's in a 3D room, and he's got a joystick to control the movement of the virtual chair. He's got to drive it up these ramps here. He's just fallen off one of the ramps. So he needs a bit more training, I think. But again, this is a project where we're taking off-the-shelf technology and using it for perhaps a serious games use. And we've had some good results from this. And yesterday, I just finished a grant application to the Innovate UK funders, which is built on this work, and hopefully will allow us to take this idea forward. So that's one example. Another example with headsets. This is some work that I'm doing at the moment with the Institute of Medicine here at Chester. And we want to help them with anatomy education. Now, the gold standard for anatomy education is to have a cadaver, and you cut up the cadaver, dissect it, and learn about the anatomy that way. But my hypothesis here is that you can get that same learning virtually by virtually dissecting a model rather than having an actual cadaver in front of you. So you can see, again, wearing the headset and using these two hand controllers, we can present you with a model, a giant foot or a brain, for example, and you can interact with that model. You can take it to bits. You can have other material like images and audio clips as well to enhance the experience. So, again, we started doing work on this. We've done some early validation of it with the medical students at Chester, and again, it looks promising. It's something that we definitely want to exploit and take forward. So those are some virtual reality examples, things I've done previously and what I'm doing now. The other disruptive technology that's starting to become more accessible is called augmented reality. Slightly different from virtual reality. With augmented reality, you have the real-world scene still visible to you, but into that real-world scene, you can superimpose any computer-generated object or information that you want to. And a couple of images here from a project that we're working on, and Mark Edwards is here, I know, who's working on this project. This is called the IPOP project, image projection onto patients. And we have this idea that we could project, as you see on the right-hand side, the anatomy onto the surface of a real person, so it could be used in the context of an anatomy lecture, maybe, or eventually into the operating theatre, where we can project onto the patient who's lying on the operating theatre useful information to help guide the surgery and the interventions that are about to be made. We're using a little area in the Thornton Science Park in that picture that's not currently used. I think it was originally a display area, but I've got my eyes on it, and I think it would make a great virtual operating theatre.
I just need to persuade the Vice-Chancellor to give me a little bit of money to refurbish the room. So
that's one of the future plans. But the first project I did with augmented reality was at Bangor, and this is Rhys, who was one of my PhD students, and we developed an anatomy education tool where we would make it appear that you could pick up volume-rendered data from a CAT scan and interact with it in your hands. So what Rhys is actually holding is a 3D print model. Again, this is the ventricles of the brain again. So he's holding that model in his hands, and we're tracking its position and orientation. And then on the monitor, we're displaying this augmented information with the volume rendered data on top of that.
So that was around about 2008 is when we started, and in 2010, we actually won a prize for best paper prize for this work. Another project that, again, is using augmented reality is this project. Oh, there's a picture of Derek again. But the little video is going to play. This was some work I was doing with the Italian Institute of Technology. One of my former PhD students was lucky to be based in Genoa for his PhD, working at the Italian Institute. And again, this is another procedure, medical procedure, using palpation. You have to find out where the pulse is. And when you know where the pulse is, you want to stick a needle into the artery. Some blood will appear here. So this is part of the blood in there from the talk, but it's only very brief. So the monitor is laid out horizontally, and you are looking down at the monitor, and it's giving you the sensation that there's a patient lying there. When you put your hands underneath the monitor, there is a video camera there, so you actually see your hands. So Tim here, you can see his hands, he's wearing latex gloves, and that is part of the augmented part. It's your hands, but a virtual patient. So he's pressing down on what looks like skin. He's actually getting a haptic response, and we'll show you shortly what is causing that. He's feeling for a pulse. He's found a pulse. He's sticking a needle in, and you can just see a little bit of red there. That's the blood. And so he's successfully punctured the artery and got some blood coming out. Let me skip on and show you a little bit of the hardware. Actually, I'll move on a little bit more. Everything is covered in a blue cloth because we're using the chroma key techniques that, you know, like they do on the BBC Weather. So you can superimpose onto a blue or green background, whatever you want. In this case, we're going to superimpose a virtual patient. And so covered in blue cloth are the force feedback joystick that we use for the needle. And if I skip on a little bit more, I've shown you the video camera. But underneath the blue cloth, this was the skin that he was pressing. It's actually a gel block with a tube going through it. We're pumping water through that tube. And that's all mounted on two other force feedback joysticks so that you can press down and get some bounce as if you're pressing on the fat of the virtual patient. They're the haptic devices again. So the haptic components were an interesting part of the project as well. And we customized them. We changed the stylus on one of the off-the-shelf joysticks. Put the C shape on it, which we could mount a real needle, so you could hold a real needle as you interact with it. So that was one of, I think, it was the first augmented reality medical training simulator that anybody had ever done. And again, it's something I want to take forward. This is another example. Francesco is also here. He works at Glan Clwyd Hospital, and he works in the radiotherapy treatment planning center, and we'd investigate an augmented reality from a tablet in context of radiotherapy treatment, and patient setup is one example. So if you hold the video camera of the tablet in front of a patient mannequin, in this case, we can start positioning the patient accurately before they have the radiotherapy treatment. So that's an ongoing project. Francesco's got to write up his thesis for now, so that's another hint for you to do that. And to bring you right up to date, Microsoft have finally produced some useful hardware. And it's called the Microsoft HoloLens. This is what it looks like. And we in Chester were one of the first universities in the UK to get our hands on these. They've only started shipping in the UK and Europe this month. But through links we have with a company, that we managed to get one a couple of months early. So we had early access to this device. The picture there, that's me with a guy called Adam Walton, who's from BBC Radio Wales. They came into Thornton Science Park just 2 weeks ago to do a feature on virtual and augmented reality. And it was much more of a challenge to talk about virtual reality to the radio audience than it is in this context, but at least I've got some videos to show you. So when you wear these goggles, you see the world around you as normal, but we can superimpose wherever we want, that's generated by the computer. And the computer is actually integrated into the headset. That headset is a complete Windows computer. And again,
Tom, my PhD student, is very excited by this, as is Francesco, actually, and we're doing some work. Actually, I'm going to start the... oops. Got a sync. I'm going to start a little video clip just to show you. I can't find my cursor. Oh, there it is. So when you wear it, we can have, in this case, we thought, let's take the anatomy from our virtual reality experience and put it into augmented reality instead for anatomy education. So here we have the anatomy floating around in the room. You can position it where you like. So here's a brain. And so you can just move it around to somewhere convenient. And then you can start to interact with it. So we highlight in pieces and then we pull them apart. And this is in an augmented reality fashion. But so that's just one example. But I think augmented reality has a huge number of possibilities. So I want to start wrapping up and talk a little bit about the current status of perhaps medical virtual reality, medical augmented reality, and what the challenges are. So this slide is about hardware. And as I said right at the beginning, I'm really, really benefiting from incredible advances in the power of hardware, graphics hardware in particular. Some people will be familiar with Moore's Law, which is how fast the CPU on a computer runs at and how that increases every 18 months, doubles in performance every 18 months. But graphics hardware far exceeds that. The graphics card that a gamer would have in their PC for a few £100s is equivalent to what Silicon Graphics was selling for tens of thousands of pounds not so long ago. I can use that. I can get affordable, real-time virtual reality and augmented reality as a result of that. Haptics as well, that's another big interest of mine, and that's starting to become more commonplace. There are devices you can buy, again, aimed at gamers, and that's bringing the price down, and we'll see more serious uses and more options in terms of force feedback joysticks and maybe things like that ultrasound prototype I showed you, direct tactile response wherever you want in a 3D space. Other sensors will start to come in as well. Smell would actually help, I think, in medical applications. The thing that I found most disturbing the first time I ever stood in on an actual operation of somebody was the smell of blood. I wasn't really expecting that. Very, very strong smell. And you needed a strong stomach as well, I think, to be able to stay in the operating theatre. So smell can also be used as part of the diagnosis of patients as well. So that's something that's yet to come. We want to model a virtual patient. So physiological modeling still has lots of challenges. This is a little movie clip from some work that Ollie did. I was another one of my former PhD students, where we wanted to have real-time soft tissue deformation integrated with haptics. That's an example where we tried to approximate reality, and I think did a reasonable job of it. Still a lot to be done in modeling physiology. There, off-the-shelf software that's available is maturing. There's a games engine called Unity, for example, which supports all the virtual reality devices I've talked about. That's incredibly useful for prototyping. And there's public domain software. The SOFA framework has been developed by a French institute, INRIA, and it's all about surgical simulation. And it's free, it's in the public domain, so we can use these types of devices. On the sort of modeling front as well, a couple of projects which I haven't really got time to talk about, so just quickly showing a slide just to mention them. Done some interesting work on trying to make anatomy look realistic. Those computer graphics guys in the audience, and there's a few of you, you wouldn't know what a BRDF is, and it's a way of describing reflection of light on a surface. Nobody's really looked at using this approach for internal anatomy, because normally you don't see the internal anatomy. But we were able to get access to some neurosurgery procedures and acquire data to enable us to create this BRDF for the brain. And a healthy brain is actually pink. I always thought it was going to be gray, because you see all these medical images and the brain's gray. But no, it's a healthy brain is pink and it looks like that. And we've been doing work to try and make the anatomy look as real as we can. I'd say blood again is another example of blood. This is ongoing work. Work that I'm doing with Serban to try and do real-time blood flow modeling, because the virtual patient will have blood going right down his arteries and his veins, and we want to be able to model that. We're investigating this directed particle system approach to give us real-time, accurate behavior for the flow velocities of blood flow, but to do it in a fraction of the computational cost. And Chris as well is working on that with us. Chris is now at Salford. I'm also seeing commercially lots happening. There are now simulators for quite a lot of different medical procedures which you can go and buy, including some products from a company called Metaphor, who Nick's involved with. And they're all advancing the field as well, introducing better modeling and better use of haptics in these commercial simulators. One area which I think is still outstanding and still a big challenge, though, is open surgery. Most of these products are minimally invasive surgery techniques where you hold in tools to do the procedure. If you're using your fingertips directly, that's a much bigger challenge, and open surgery techniques is one of the things I want to continue to investigate. And it's all this thing about fidelity as well. You don't always need very, very high fidelity in order to create the purpose that you're interested in. So that training how to do a technique, learning the hand-eye coordination that you need, doesn't necessarily mean that you have to present them with a completely lifelike virtual environment to train in. And our iPad low fidelity solution has sort of shown that. It's outperforming a more higher fidelity version. And the fidelity you need might change as well. So a more experienced person just needs to refresh himself how to do a procedure because he hasn't done it for a couple of weeks. Could get away with a much lower fidelity, perhaps, environment than the raw medical student. So that's another interesting research area that we're exploring is, you know, what do you actually need to do in order to have a convincing tool that works? And to prove it works, we need to do validation studies as well. And I haven't really talked a lot about that in this talk, but all these bits of technology that we're putting together, great fun as a computer scientist to do that, but we have to prove that it works. And we have to go out into the hospitals, get the end user experts to use these tools, and statistically prove that if they learn to train on this virtual reality tool, they are actually learning how to do that procedure on a real person, not just how to use this virtual reality tool. The Latin there is actually the University of Chester's motto. I thought that was a good place to put that. I'm not going to tell you what it means. That's your homework. But I thought it fitted in there. And you can find out what that means later. So validation studies are important. I'm just going to finish all. We'll finish now. This is one example of a validation study we did quite recently. And I'm going back to the wheelchair virtual reality environment, which I talked about. And to do a validation study on that, we set up an obstacle course at Thornton Science Park, and we had a real wheelchair. And to get a baseline level of skill for our volunteers, they were able-bodied volunteers, we timed them doing this obstacle course. Then some of them went away and trained in a VR environment, others didn't, and then we compared their performance again. And just to show you that we've got lots of really keen volunteers at Thornton to help us in our validation studies. I've got one clip here, which I'd like to show you, the skill of our able-bodied users of motorized wheelchairs. So you get my point about crashing into doorways and furniture, and that is so difficult to get expert enough at these things so you can just glide in. And Nick, with our help and our VR simulator, we'll get there. You will get there. So I need to end with some acknowledgements. And I started to write down the names of everybody I've been working with and all these projects I've been talking about today. And I realized I was going to need 3 or 4 slides of names to get everybody in. It was just impossible. I've been really lucky over the years to work with some great people, great colleagues, had great PhD students. Many now are lecturers themselves. So I couldn't put all the names down. So what I thought I'd do instead was put all the logos down of all the companies, universities, and institutes that I've been involved with and been proud to be part of, and have been the catalyst for all the projects that I've been doing. So there, though, there's the all the places I've been proud to be part of. And I'm going to finish there. So thank you very much for your attention, and I'd be very happy to take any questions.
I'll get you back for that last clip. Don't worry. All right. Okay. So we'd like to invite some questions. We have some microphones roaming around. So please, if you can just wait for the microphone. Great.
It struck me that some of these techniques would have enormous advantage to trainee vets. Mm. Are you expanding into this field at all? Is anybody?
I personally haven't worked with any veterinary scientists, but definitely that they are using this technology. That there's, I know in the London Vet School, there's already a lady there who's done a lot of work with haptic devices, and they have a haptic cow. So you know, you put your hands through the buttocks of a mannequin of a cow, and you can feel the right sort of haptic response for, you know, where, if their calf was trapped and you have to manipulate it. So vets are using this technology. They're probably not quite as common as in the hospitals, but yeah, they are, and that will happen for sure.
Okay, thank you. So,
Derek.
Fantastic talk. Love this, Nigel. Brought so many memories back. But I do remember not long after we met at the beginning of this century, I think, we were sitting around a table with proponents from other universities. I remember the late, great Roger Phillips answering a question I posed to him, which was, how long will it take for us to simulate something like a human aorta such that we would truly suspend disbelief when examining and touching that organ? And he thought for a moment and he said, not in our lifetimes. And do you think that's still true, or do you think we've made extraordinary progress since then?
Definitely the progress is exponential, and if it continues on an exponential growth, we could achieve that. But I would also question, do we need that in order to impart the training experience that you want to teach? Because maybe we don't need to get to that holy grail, if you like, and something that approximates that is more than sufficient to teach the training task. So, yeah, I mean, I think we will get to that level of reality, possibly within our lifetimes, maybe not, but we certainly will produce useful tools that will have added value in the operating theatre and hospitals.
Thanks.
Thank you, Nigel. Enjoyable as ever. I have a question about validation, because what you do, you verify, and you verify in the labs that Nick can't drive through a door, and then you have to validate it for actual use. And you mentioned collaboration with psychology. Are there other multidisciplinary areas that you'd like to bring into your future research? And what is the role of these other multidisciplinary areas in validating what you are?
Well, most of the experts are in the psychology field, people like Simon. And in the CRAVE Consortium, we had somebody called Sheena Johnson, who was based at Manchester University. And they just knew both ends of the pipeline, if you like. They're really useful for the task analysis to understand exactly what the real procedure is all about and how we can actually document that and understand it. And then we go away and build something. And then when we try to prove that it works, you know, there are standard methodologies for looking at differences in ability from the expert and the novices, and transfer of training skills from any tool into the real workplace. And it is the psychologists who would know how to do that more than I do, and so it's been great to work with them. None of what I've shown today can be done by one discipline alone. And we need the computer scientists who can build the things. We need the engineers to perhaps build some custom hardware for us. We need the psychologists. We need the end user experts. So you definitely need that multidisciplinary team in order to make progress.
Oh, really interesting talk. Thanks ever so much. One of the things that struck me about it, and probably some of my computer science colleagues here as well, is dealing with this rapid change that happens all the time when you're working with computers. And I wonder if you could tell me some of the things that haven't changed. You know, what are the sort of crystal parts of what hasn't changed over that
time? What hasn't changed? Gosh, that's an interesting question. A computer program and the language you're using hasn't changed that much, really. The what we're doing behind the scenes to implement all these algorithms, we're still using pretty much the same tools. Now, they might be a bit more sophisticated in terms of the development environment and the debugging, but C program is still a C program. So I think the algorithms they are developing, but the way that we describe and document the procedure that we want to perhaps simulate, that process hasn't changed, but the technology that we're using to achieve that is changing a lot and getting better and faster. And
Nigel, that was really interesting.
Microphone's died, I've got a very loud voice. One of the things which really interests me about what you described, and you talked a lot about the haptics and the tactile, of the virtual reality and the augmented reality, but recognising there's a lot of focus in health also around mental health and well-being and that community component. Again, do you see those opportunities there in developing those virtual consultations and those virtual engagements, especially as you described that you can put a lot more of that hologramic tactile components around, particularly mental health areas.
I mean, you're right. You can use, and rehabilitation as well is another area which I haven't really talked about, where you can expose a patient to a virtual environment, not to train them to do something, but maybe to desensitize them from something, or to phobia treatment is another area, perhaps related to mental health, where you can actually cure people of fear of spiders, and then by exposing them in this virtual environment to whatever it is they're afraid of. So that's another related area with a huge amount of work already ongoing in that area, and again, I think could have some interesting results.
Okay, any more questions for Nigel?
Phil.
Thank you. First of all, a comment. I've met many professors who try to convince me what a fine brain they've got. You're the first one who's actually showed me. I really want to just make a passing comment. You came through Bath, of course, and it was a delight to supervise you. I had no idea then how you were going to turn out, Nigel. I mean, I knew you were good, but I didn't know how good. I've sat here this evening being astonished by everything you've done. There's lots there that I didn't know about, as well as the stuff I did know about. It's made me proud to be here tonight, so thank you very much for everything you've achieved.
Thank you, Phil.
Okay, I think on that note, I'd like to invite Derek up to do a vote of thanks. Derek.
Thanks, Nick, and thanks, Nigel, for showing us that computer scientists are the guys with the very best toys. Nigel's shown us the massive advances in computing technology since he and I first met, as I intimated in 2000. As an interventional radiologist with an interest in simulating interventional radiology procedures, I asked around locally in Liverpool where I might go to find someone who was interested in developing that sort of technology, and everyone said, go and talk to Dr. Nigel John at the Manchester Visualization Center. So I duly went along, and Nigel showed me around his Aladdin's cave of technology, his interface devices, and then a reach-in device. And of course, as you've seen tonight, the technology has moved on enormously since then. But we went on to bring together a group of interested collaborators around the table, and we went on to develop and deliver projects and perform validations on the technologies that the CRAVE consortium produced. And many of the CRAVE collaborators are here tonight with us. By 2006, Nigel was already in a chair at Bangor when he received the Satava Award in California, as Nick told us earlier on. And it was a delight to be there and see that, and to see such a truly humble person as Nigel, who nonetheless has engendered some prodigious research that we've seen tonight receive this truly justly deserved award. Of course, Nigel's other loves, other than his computer science and his family, Shirley and Mark and Megan, and Welsh Rugby Union, include his titanium Linsky road racing bike. And I'm so disappointed to find that now Nigel is beating me up the hills of North Wales on his bike, and it's telling me I must work much harder. Tonight we've seen the prodigious and highly focused nature of his work, answering questions that naturally arise in any type of research, which generate new questions to address. Beautifully presented by Nigel, and truly prescient in his vision of what is ultimately going to be possible and the steps towards that that are necessary. He has shown us how he is poised to flourish amidst the new opportunities at Chester and in the context of a new medical school. I'm sure he will take advantage of these ever more exciting technologies. We can see where that is going and perhaps have a glimmering of where Nigel will be in another decade or two. It was exciting to see the potential of head-mounted displays and the humble, omnipresent iPad in creating exemplars of virtual reality technology, for example, for teaching. Plus, augmenting the real-world perceptions that we have to enhance the accuracy of the human skill set in augmented reality, such as in surgery and in radiotherapy, and perhaps using this new, exciting Microsoft HoloLens device. At the same time, Nigel has shown us the importance of balancing the technology costs against the level of fidelity required and the ultimate need for validation of these technologies before they're put into clinical practice. So tonight we've seen the extraordinary research powerhouse that is Professor Nigel John. I'm so pleased to be his colleague and his friend, and I'd like you to join me in thanking Nigel for this lecture in the usual way.